Hello all, welcome to the online lecture series of Rajagiri School of Engineering and Technology. I am Anjushree VK, Assistant Professor, Department of Computer Science and Engineering. In this session, I will be dealing with the part 2 of module 3. So students, this is actually the continuation of part 1. Before moving to this session, you have to know about part 1. I'll be discussing these contents, elaborating these contents like multiprocessor system interconnects, hierarchical bus system, crossbar switch, multi-port memory, multi-stage and combining network. In part 1, I described the introduction of these topics, and in this session, I'll be describing in detail about this. Starting with the hierarchical bus system, so this bus system is actually an example of dynamic interconnection network. In the part 1 session, I discussed in detail about what is a dynamic interconnection network and what are the examples coming under dynamic interconnection network. Here in the hierarchical bus system, it is actually consists of a hierarchy of buses that connects various system and subsystem components in a computer, and each bus is formed with a number of signal, control and power lines. And you can see here different buses that are actually used to perform different interconnection function. And you can see here the boards. So at the center part, you can see the system bus, which is actually known as the backplane bus. And here you can see the CPU board. In the CPU board, you can see the local bus that actually connects the local memory, cache, CPU, and as well as the interface logic, and the IO controller is also present here. So that is the CPU board. In the CPU board, the local bus, and on the memory board, you can see the memory bus, which actually interconnects the memory cells, the memory controller, the interface logic and all. So that is the memory bus, which is actually located on the memory board. And one more thing, the data bus is present. The data bus you can see both on the IO board as well as on the communication board. So it is actually its purpose is actually to transmit the data. So that is actually acting on the IO board as well as the communication board, and all these boards are actually coordinated by means of the system bus, otherwise known as the backplane bus. So let's check in detail about each. So the first one is the local bus that is actually located on the CPU board, and the buses, the local bus, which is actually implemented within the processor chip or on the printed circuit board, and they are known as the local bus. And the main thing or the main functionality of this bus is which provides a common communication path among the major components mounted on the board. That is actually the main functionality of a local bus. The next one is a memory bus. The memory board is actually uses a memory bus that connects the memory with the interface logic. That is about the memory bus. Next, coming to the data bus, so the data bus is actually located on both the, you can see it both on the IO board as well as on the communication board. An IO or network interface chip or board uses the data bus, mainly used for data transfer. Next is the backplane bus. A backplane bus is a printed circuit on which many connectors are used to plug in functional boards. A system bus consisting of shared signals, paths and utility lines is built on the backplane. The system bus provides a common communication path among all the plug-in boards. So you can see the different types of functionality or the different boards are actually connected on the backplane bus that we saw in the next, the last one, which is the IO bus, which is the input output devices are connected to a computer system through an IO bus such as the SCSI, that is the small computer system interface bus. This bus is actually made up of coaxial cables with the tabs connecting disk, printer and other devices to a processor through an IO controller. So input output devices are connected to the device mainly through the IO bus, which is also known as example is SCSI, that is the small computer system interface bus. Next is the hierarchical buses and caches. So here you can see a tree like structure. So the tree like structure, it is actually showing the different levels of caches and processes. So the deep most level, or otherwise the leaf nodes, you can see it is actually the processes and the caches. So the processes that are located here will be communicating with the caches that are known as the first level cache. So they will be providing data to the processes. And you can see a cluster bus. So this, you can consider this lowermost level as a cluster. If you are considering this section, you can consider P0, C10, P1, C11, P2, C12. So all these can be considered as a cluster. So if P6 require a data, then it will be communicating with C16. If the data is not present in C16, this P6 can communicate with the P8, or it can communicate with the C18 for getting the data by means of a cluster bus. So this three bunches of this processor and cache can be considered as a cluster. So the processors will be communicating within this cluster using the cluster bus. Next is the second level cache. If the data is not present in that cache also, then it can communicate with the second level cache. It can go and request the second level cache. So the second level cache will be providing the data if the data is not present within that cluster also. And the second level caches, here it is denoted as C2I. So I can vary from 0 to 2. And it is used between each cluster bus and the intercluster bus. So this is the cluster bus, and you can see the intercluster bus. So if the if you are considering this as a cluster and this as a second cluster, suppose C22 is present in one cluster and C20 is present in another cluster. So if these two clusters want to communicate between each other, they can use the intercluster bus. So the intercluster bus is actually providing the way for communicating between two clusters. That is about the intercluster bus. And the intercluster bus can also be used for communicating with the main memory. If the caches is not available with the required data, it can go and communicate with the main memory through this intercluster bus. So the intercluster bus provides a way for communicating between the clusters as well as with the main memory. That is about the hierarchical buses and the caches. In the previous slide, I discussed about one type of dynamic interconnection network, which was the hierarchical bus system. And from this slide onwards, I'm going to discuss about another type of dynamic interconnection network. Basically, these are switched networks. So switched networks provide a dynamic interconnection between the inputs and the output. And the major classes of switched networks are specified based on the number of stages and blocking or non-blocking. So the networks that I am going to discuss in this part is based on the number of stages and whether it is blocking or non-blocking. The crossbar networks and the multi-port memory structures will be discussing first, and after that the multi-stage network will be discussed. And here the network stages, depending upon the number of interstage connection, we can divide the network into two. One is a single stage network and the multi-stage network. Single stage network can also be called as a recirculating network. So here the data items may have to recirculate through the single stage many times before reaching the destination. The best example in coming under the single stage network is crossbar network and the multi-port memory. The second thing is the multi-stage network, where have more than one stage of switch boxes. So there will be more than one stage of switch boxes present. Such a network should be able to connect from any input to any output. So that is the speciality of multi-stage network. And the basic multi-stage networks are Omega network, baseline network, flip networks, So all these are actually examples of dynamic interconnection network. So in the case of dynamic interconnection network, based on the number of switch stages, you can divide as a single stage network and multi-stage network. The next classification is based on blocking or non-block. So blocking versus non-blocking network. So a multi-stage network is called as blocking if the simultaneous connections of some multiple input-output pairs may result in conflict in the use of switches or communication links. So in the cases, as I discussed in part 1, there will be input ports and output ports will be there. And if multiple inputs are actually trying to use the same output channel, that may result for a conflict. Such type of networks are called a blocking network. So basically this blocking network will be coming in multi-stage network. And examples of this blocking network are Omega network and the baseline network. And a multi-stage network is called a non-blocking if it can perform all possible connection between inputs and output by rearranging its connection. So even if the blocking will come, yes, there is a chance to occur blocking, the network will automatically rearrange the connection and avoids the blocking there. So that type of networks are called a non-blocking network. In such a network, connection path can always be established with any input-output pair. And the best example is the beans network. So these are the two classifications of this switched networks. So in the case of switched network, two classifications are there: single stage network or multi-stage network, and also based on blocking or non-blocking. The first one is the crossbar network. So the crossbar network is actually a single stage network. And in a crossbar network, every input port is connected to a free output port through a cross point switch without blocking. And a crossbar network, it is actually a single stage network as I said, and which consists of unary switches at the cross points. Once the data is read from the memory, its value is returned to the requesting processor along the same cross point switch. So crossbar switch network is a single stage non-blocking permutation network, and each cross point in a crossbar network is a unary switch which can be set open or closed, providing a point-to-point connection path between the source and the destination. So I will explain in detail about the crossbar network using a figure. So you can see a figure here. This is actually showing the use of the crossbar network. Here you can see the processors P1, P2, etc. up to P16 and the memory cells M1, M2, etc. up to M16. So there are 16 processors and 16 memories. So this is actually a 16x16 crossbar network. So here you can see each and every processor. If you are taking the processor P1, it is actually connected with M1, M2 and M3 etc. up to M16 using the cross point switch. You can see the small circle here. These are actually the cross point switches. So this cross point switch, we can make it open or closed. So the P1, if it needs to communicate with M1, it will be communicating with the cross point switch that is present here, and it will be sending data to the memory M1. And if it needs to read the data from M1, then also it will be using the same cross point switch. So that's why in the previous slide, as I said, that both the communication towards the memory and towards the processor will be taking place by means of the same switch. Okay, and if you are taking P2, P2 will be also using a cross point switch here with M1, again with M2 and up to M16. Like that, for the 16 processor, that means for the N processors, each and every processor will have a connection with the memory modules using the crossbar switch or cross point switch, and the communication to and fro communication with the processor and with the memory will be doing by means of the same cross point switch. And It requires, the network actually requires the use of n cross m cross point switches. So n will be the number of processor and m will be the number of memory cells. All processors can send memory requests independently and asynchronously. So the processors that are present here will be sending requests to the memory independently and asynchronously. And this poses the problem of multiple requests designed for the same memory module at the same time. That is actually the biggest disadvantage of this crossbar network. So if you are checking this, you can see, suppose if I am taking the memory M1 and suppose at T time is equal to 100 or time is equal to 8:15 a.m. P1 is actually sending a request to M1 via its cross point. P2 is also sending the request to M1 via its cross point, and assume that P16 is also sending a request to M1 using the same cross point. So that is actually creating a conflict there. So that is actually a problem in the case of this crossbar switch. Multiple requests will be running in the same memory module at the same time. So this network is basically used for small or medium sized systems. So out of this n cross point switches in each column of an n cross m crossbar mesh, only one can be connected at a time. That is the problem. Even if the memory is receiving n number of requests, it can only serve at one at a particular time. So in order to resolve the contention for each memory module, each cross point switch must be designed with extra hardware. So I will be discussing here about the design of a cross point switch. So in order to avoid this type of contentions, there should be some extra hardware to avoid this. So on each row of the crossbar mesh, multiple cross point switches can be connected simultaneously. Here you can see this is actually a schematic design of a row of a cross point switch in a crossbar network, and here you can see this is the shared memory module, and here you can see a multiplexer. The multiplexer is the one that decides which particular request should be forwarded to the memory. So here you can see n number of processors are actually connected to the multiplexer. This is actually showing a row of a cross point switch. So the particular row is actually receiving multiple requests, and the number of data request and the address request will be receiving at the multiplexer. So the multiplexer will be directing or will be selecting one. That is, an n input multiplexer will be selecting only one request or one. Next is about the limitations of crossbar network. So if you are considering a crossbar network, it is actually very cost effective, and it is cost effective only for a small number of processors as well as those set of systems that are having a few processors and will be able to access only a few memory modules. And also a single stage crossbar network is not expandable once it is built. That is, these are the limitations of crossbar network. It is not scalable. Okay. And coming to the advantage of a crossbar network, a single processor can send many requests to multiple memory modules. So in the crossbar line, you already saw that the different cross point switches. So using each cross point switches, a single processor can access different memory modules M1, M2, M3, etc. And also for an n cross m crossbar network, at most n memory words can be delivered to at most n processors in each cycle. Similarly, for the memory also, each and every memory module can deliver the or it can serve each and every processors, those processors requested for the data. And the redundancy, if you are implementing redundancy or parity checking in this cross point switches, you can also enhance the fault tolerance and reliability of the crossbar network. These are the limitations and advantages of crossbar network. Next is about the multi-port memory. in the case of a multi-port memory, all cross point arbitration and switching functions associated with each memory module are actually moved into a memory controller. I will show the figure of the multi-port memory in the next slide. And in this case, as I said, now all the cross point switches and its associated functions are actually lying inside the cross point switch, and thus the memory module becomes more expensive due to the added access ports and associated logic. So in this case, more functions and more logic are present in the memory module, so it will be more expensive. And only one of the n processor requests can be honored at a time. At a time, you can only serve one processor. Even if there are multiple ports in the memory, then you can only serve one of the n processor requests at a time. So the multi-port memory organization is actually a compromise solution between a low-cost, low-performance bus system and a high-cost, high-bandwidth cross-bus system. These are the important concepts about the multi-port memory. So this memory structure is actually more expensive when the number of processors as well as the number of memory modules increases. This multi-port memory is also very expensive, and a multi-port memory multiprocessor is not scalable because once the ports are fixed, no more processors can be added without redesigning the memory controller. So a large number of interconnection cables and connectors are required when this number of processors and memory modules increases. This is the picture representation of multi-port memory. So here you can see these are the memory modules, and as I said, you can see n number of ports that are located in each and every memory module. And these memory modules have these switching functions of the cross point switches and the arbitration logic. They are actually present inside this memory module, and you can see the P1 processor, P2 processor, etc. N processors are connected to a single memory module by means of these ports. Even if n ports are present, only a single processor will be served at a time. That is one of the main thing you have to consider in the case of multi-port memory, and it is not scalable, which means you cannot expand or you cannot add up more number of processors once the connection is fixed, because we need to design the ports in order to accommodate more number of processors. So that is not possible in the case of this multi-port memory. And this is actually another way of representing memory ports with privileged ports or prioritized ports. So here you can see the ports are actually numbered like 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. So each and every port is connected with the processor, I/O devices or another processor. So in that case, if you are giving priority for the port numbers, when the interrupt or a request comes to the memory module, according to the priority value, the memory module will serve the request. So this is a different representation of the multi-port memory. So here the privileged ports or the prioritized ports are used in order to prioritize the requests coming from the processors and the I/O devices. That's all about multi-port memory. Next is about the multi-stage and companion network. So regarding a multi-stage network, it is actually used in large multiprocessor system, and the combining mechanism is also there in order to avoid the conflicts that are actually occurring in this multi-stage network. Two types of multi-stage networks are there. One is Omega network and another one is Butterfly network. About routing in Omega network, in the starting slide and in which means the part 1 session, already I explained about the structure of an Omega network. So if it is an n input Omega network, as an Omega network have different stages, there will be log n to the base 2 stages in an Omega network. And the stages will be most probably labeled from 0 to log n to the base 2 minus 1. So if three stages are there, stage 0, stage 1, stage 2 are the labels of the stages. Okay, then coming to the number of switch modules, as you saw the figure, you will be able to understand different switches will be present in each and every stage. So there will be n by 2 switch modules in an Omega network. And the routing, outside the switch boxes you have to use the perfect shuffle which I mentioned in part 1, and inside the switch the broadcasting towards the output ports will be done based on a rule. The rule is like this: if the higher order bit is a 0, connect to the higher output, else connect to the lower output. So this is the one that is followed inside the switch box. So these are the possible combination of an omega network. That means the connection inside the switch, this is actually the higher output and this one is the lower output. So inside the switch you need to use the rule that I mentioned just before. So if the higher bit is actually 1, which means you can direct the output towards the lower half, and if it is 0, you can direct it towards the upper half. So that is the combination, that is the routing manner inside the switch. So these are the possible strategies that you will be getting inside the switch. Straight connections will be there, crossover connections will be there, broadcast type connection will be there, lower broadcast and upper broadcast are two types of broadcast connection most possibly coming in this omega network. So this is an example of an omega network that is without a blocking. Already I mentioned about the blocking and non-blocking network. So this is an 8 input omega network, which means n value is 8. And here you can see the total number of stages that is labeled from 0 onwards. So stage 0 to stage 2, which is stage 2 is log n to the base 2 value of this 8 input omega network. So 2 raised to 3 will be the power representation of the 8, the number 8. So it will be, the total number of stages will be 3, as it is 2 raised to 3, 4. And the number of switches in each and every stage is n by 2, which is actually 8 by 2, which is 4. And it is a 2 cross 2 switch, which means in each and every stage you will be using a 2 cross 2 switch. And this is the permutation function that you are going to implement in this 8 input omega network. So 0, 7, 6, 4, 2, 1, 3, 5, 3 permutation groups are there. So on using bijection mapping, you will get the mapping like this: 0 to 7, 7 to 6, 6 to 4, 4 to 2, 2 to 0, 1 to 3, 3 to 1, 5 to 5. This is the mapping. And this is the first step, that means you will be getting the number of stages, 3 stages that I labeled as 0, 1 and 2. Then also number of switches 1, 2, 3, 4, n by 2 number of switches in each and every stage. And the input and output representation, as it is an 8 input omega network, we need to represent it as 2 raised to 3, that means with using 3 bits we need to represent it. So 0000001 up to 111, I have to represent the bits, input and the output bits. Okay, and the mapping is also available. So we know about the input and output mapping. 0 should be mapped to 7, 7 should be mapped to 6, 6 should be mapped to 4, 4 to 2, 2 to 0. Like that, we need to map each and every input to the output ports for the output function. Okay. So, as I explained earlier, outside the switch we need to use the perfect shuffle and inside the switch we need to use the rule. So, already I mentioned in session 1 about the perfect shuffle. These are the combinations or the 3-bit combinations of the perfect shuffle. So, this is the first step. I am supposed to send a message from 001 to 011. So from 001 to 011 I am going to send a message. That is the mapping that I am going to take here is 1 to 3. So I need to find out where is 1. This is 1 and I am going to map this 1 to this 3. Okay. So for that I need to consider each and every switch boxes. To which switch I need to map 1. That I need to locate first. As it is outside the switch connection, I need to use the perfect shuffle. So according to perfect shuffle, 001 will be mapped to 010. So from 001 I can draw a line outside the switch. I am going to use perfect shuffle. So from 001 I am going to map 010. Okay. And inside the switch I need to use the rule that I mentioned earlier. So for that I need to check each and every bit one by one. So for the current point of time, as it is the stage or the
I need to check the MSB value of this number. That means I am going to take the destination of this mapping. The destination is 1 to 3, so I need to check the MSB value of the destination. So the MSB value of the destination is 0 here. So as it is 0, I need to route what to the upper value or to the upper point. And again, I am moving to the stage 1. From stage 0, I need to move to the stage 1. So outside the switch, I need to use the perfect shuffle. Now I am residing at the port 2 of second switch in stage 0. So from this, to which switch in stage 1 I need to map. For that I need to again use the perfect shuffle. So 2 is 010. So while doing perfect shuffle on 010, I will be getting 100. So I can assure that the connection will be to 100. Okay. And again inside the switch I need to perform the routing. So inside the switch I need to take the route. So here in the previous case I took the first bit. As it is the second stage, I need to choose the second bit. The second bit is a 1. So if it is a 1, I need to route towards the lower bit. So I will be routing towards the lower bit. Okay. And again outside the switch I need to use the perfect shuffle. This is the fifth port of stage 1 third switch. So I need to choose the next switch in stage 2. Okay, for that I need to use the perfect shuffle as it's outside the switch. So 0101 is the binary for 5. So 101 will be mapped to 011. So I'll be able to connect this fifth port to the third port. Again inside the switch I need to do what the routing based on the rule. So it is this time I'm going to check the last bit, which is the stage 2. I am lying in the stage 2. So now I need to take the last bit. So 011, last bit is 1. So when 1 occurs, what happens? I need to route towards the lower. So finally I reach the destination 011. So that is about. Similarly, I am taking another case, which is 6 to 4. The mapping from 6 to 4. 6 is 110 and 4 is 100. So I need to route from 110 to 100 to here. Okay, so 110 is here. So outside the switch I need to use the perfect shuffle. I need to find out to which switch I need to map this 110. So for that I need to use perfect shuffle. So 110 will be mapped to 101. Okay, inside the switch again I am going to use the rule. So according to the rule, the MSB position is 1. So if it is a 1, I can route towards what the lower bit. So again I am coming outside of the switch. So outside the switch again what the perfect shuffle. So according to perfect shuffle, 0101 will be mapped to 011. Inside the switch I need to check the bit, the second bit, it is 0. So as it is 0, I can route towards the higher output. So again outside the switch, what happens? It is actually the second port. So the second port is 010, so which is mapped to 100. Okay, and finally as the bit is 0, it will be directed to the higher output itself, finally reached to 100. So this will be the final representation that you will be getting for the permutation 0764 to 135. So this is actually without any blocking. And this is actually an example with the blocking. All the condition that I mentioned for the previous example is also existing here. Okay, this is also an 8 input omega network. For the n value is 8 and the stages are numbered from 0 to 2. And 4 switches also present. As the equation is n by 2, n will take the value 8. Then 2 cross 2 switch, the permutation is pi 2, which is 0647315 2. This is the mapping for the permutation. So starting with this, I am taking here two permutations. One is 000 to 110 and another one is 100 to 111. These are the messages that I am going to take here. So here I am going to send first the data from 000 to 110. So where is 000? This is 000. And where is 110? This is 110. Okay. So 000, I need to choose the switch. Outside the switch, perfect shuffle 000 to 00 itself. Inside the switch, I need to check the destination bit. The destination is 110. So 110, according to 110, it is routing towards what allower as the bit is 1. So again, coming outside the switch, I need to choose the switch in the second stage. So from 001 to which port I will map. For that, again going for perfect shuffle, which is 010. Inside the switch, again going to use the roll, which is the second bit, it is a 1. So I am going to direct towards the lower bit. Again, I am coming outside the switch, so I need to use what the perfect shuffle. So it is the third location or the third bit, 110 will be mapped to 011 will be mapped to 110. Okay, so finally the inner part, which is the we need to check the bit again here. So it's 0, so mapping towards the higher output, finally I reach the destination. So what happens when the message from 100 to 111 is also sent during this time? So during this time, when I am sending the message from 100 to 111, 100 is here and 111 is here. So I am going to send the data from 100 to 111. So outside the switch, I need to use the perfect shuffle. So I need to find out which switch I need to map first. So 100, while doing perfect shuffle, it is 001. Okay, and inside the switch I need to use what the rule. So my destination bit is 1114 here. So according to 111, I am going to take what? I am going to take the first bit. So here, as it is stage 0, I am going to take the first bit, which is 1. So if it is a 1, I can direct towards what? The lower bit. Okay, so what happens here? Here the two signals are actually colliding at the same port, which is actually known as a blocking. Okay, and also if you are going for another one, which is 0111 to 000 and 111 to 011, so this will also make a collision here. So you can see here 0111 to 000. So where is 011? Here you can see the 011. So if I am directing that, the arrows will come like this: perfect shuffle, routing, perfect shuffle, routing, perfect shuffle, routing. This is for the first one, and for 111 to 011, with this will be like here also the collision comes similar to the previous one. Okay, so blocking again comes here. So this is the reason for causing blocking. If two or more signals are meeting at a same point, it will block the signals entirely. Okay, the signal will not forward after that. And this is actually the final diagram for the blocking network for the permutation 06473152. So here you can clearly identify the nodes that causes or the switches that causes the blocking. So here G, F, H, I, J, these are the switches that actually causes the blocking. Generally we can say like this: if you are taking an n input omega network, can only implement n raised to n by 2 permutations in a single pass. All others will cause blocking and demand up to 3 passes to be realized. So generally there is an equation for this. In general, a maximum of log n to the base 2 passes are needed for an n input omega network. So you cannot implement all the permutations using a single pass. So in order to implement the permutation in an n input omega network, maximum log n to the base 2 passes are required. Okay, so that is a general concept regarding this omega network. And also only in a single pass only n raised to n by 2 permutations are implementable, and maximum you require n raised log n to the base 2 passes for completely implementing an n input omega network. Suppose if you are considering n value as 8, which is actually if you are taking n raised to n by 2, it will be 8 raised to 4 divided by n factorial. That will give you the percentage of permutation that are implementable in a single pass through an n input omega network. So if you want to find out the percentage of permutation that can be implemented in a single pass, you have to divide n raised to n by 2 divided by n factorial. Actually, the blocking is not a desired factor in any multi-stage network, blocking will always pose or it will always lowers the bandwidth, effective bandwidth. That is, blocking is always a disadvantage in an Omega network. Next is another type of connection. This is a broadcast connection for in the Omega network. Here you can see 001 is the starting point here. From here, broadcasting starts. That means the signal is broadcasted to the two output ports. From there, using perfect shuffle, it reaches other. According to perfect shuffle, it reaches the switches. The two signals that are emerging from this output, which reaching at the switch points of two other switches in stage two. Then after that, again broadcasting happens. Here you can see. Then finally, again uses perfect shuffle to reach each and every node. So you can see here clearly that the input, a single input, is actually reaching all the 8 outputs. So that type of a broadcast connection is also possible in the case of Omega network. Next is about routing in the butterfly network. This class of network is constructed with the crossbar switches as building blocks. Here also the main building unit is crossbar switches. The 8-way shuffle function is used to establish the interstage connection between stage 0 and stage 1. Here instead of the perfect shuffle function, an 8-way function is actually using for interconnecting between the stages. So no broadcast connections are allowed in a butterfly network, and it is actually a restricted subclass of Omega network. This is figure corresponding to the butterfly network. This is actually a 64 input network. So you can see the 64 numbers are actually written here. And as it is a 64 input network, we are using an 8x8 switch, and it is actually using 8-way shuffle. So as it is an 8x8 switch, so an 8x8-way shuffle function is using in order to interconnect between the stage 0 and the stage 1. So why two stages only? Because when we are taking log 64 to the base 8, as it is an 8x8 network, it is log 64 to the base 8. So for the it will be 2. Okay, so that's why it is there are only two stages. For the Omega network, it is two. It is a 2x2 switch. We use 2x2 switch. So log n to the base 2. So that's why the base value became 2, and here the base value is 8 as it is an 8x8. So this is all about the butterfly network. Next is another problem in the case of this Omega network, which is known as a hotspot problem. So this is actually the network due to the non-uniform network transfer. A hotspot may appear corresponding to a certain memory module using excessively, that is being excessively accessed by many processors at the same time. So if a memory module is there, and if continuous non-uniform traffic are actually attacking that memory module, so that may cause some problem, or that may delay the functionality of that memory module. So that is known as a hotspot problem. So that this hotspots may degrade the network performance significantly, and we can use as a technique known as combining mechanism in Omega network in order to avoid the hotspot problem. So the purpose of this combining mechanism is to combine multiple requests that are directed towards the same destination, and at the switch points where the conflict is actually occurring, it will combine the multiple requests, and it will direct the combined request to the memory module. So that is about the hotspot problem and the combining mechanism used to solve the hotspot problem normally occurring in Omega network. Next is about combining mechanism, which is implemented by means of a function known as fetch and add. Here the function fetch and add of x, e means x is an integer variable and it is in shared memory, and e is an integer increment to x. When a single processor actually initiates this function, it is a normal increment and the result is consistent. But when n process attempt at the same memory word simultaneously, The memory will be only updated once, and it follows a serialization principle. That means if the switch that is located at the middle of this memory and the processor, it will combine this all the request, and it will forward that request to the memory in a combined form. So the updation will be done only once. Next is the values returned to the end request are all unique depending on the serialization order followed. The net result is similar to a sequential execution of n fetch and adds, but is performed in one indivisible operation. The fetch and add primitive is very effective in accessing sequentially allocated queue structure in parallel. That is about the fetch and add operation, that is a mechanism. This figure clearly indicates the fetch and add mechanism. Here you can see processor P1 and P2 issues the fetch and add of x, e1 as well as x, e2 towards the switch module, and the switch will forward that as a combined request to the memory module. So this switch is actually adding the contents of E1 and E2 to X, and it will store the final result in the memory. So the processor P1 as well as P2 is actually seeing, they are actually seeing a unique view of this memory. But what about the return value? If suppose P1 is expecting X as a return value and P2 is expecting X plus E1 as a return value, how the result or the how the return value will be forwarded by the switch? For that, the switch will be using a buffer, and in that buffer it will be storing E1 or E2 according to the requirement of P1 and P2. So after the result is added and when it is stored in the memory, the return value from the main memory will be only X, and when the X reaches the switch, so it will be added with E1 and it will be given to P2, and X alone is given to P1. So this is the structure, or this is the way by which the combining mechanism works in the case of a fetch and add operation. That's all about the session. Thank you very much. This is the reference. You can refer the textbook for more details. Thank you.